For a brief moment in the late 90s and early 2000s, new metal ruled the airwaves.
Cut my life into pieces!
With releases such as Korn's Follow the Leader, Limp Bizkit's Significant Other, and Linkin Park's Hybrid Theory, the genre had commercial clout, but critically fared less well. Nowadays, the genre is seen as a cultural low point in rock music, a phase that it had to go through, but still an embarrassing one. But to its credit, the genre fused together many different musical elements that had previously seemed incompatible, and moved us closer to the modern musical landscape, where genre really isn't a thing anymore. But how did we get here? What steps were vital along the way? And were we ever fully ready for Korn? The moment that rock music first interacted with rap in a meaningful way was because of Run DMC. They had mixed session rock guitar with their flows as early as 1984's Rock Box. But the moment where this cultural collision hit the mainstream was on Walk This Way, their 1986 collaboration with Aerosmith. Producer Rick Rubin had gotten the idea from finding Aerosmith's Toys in the Attic LP in Run DMC's record crate.
We liked the hardcore beat. We had to find something to rap over. This is before rap records was even made. So what we wanted to do, we were looking through these jammies, and we found this one called Walk This Way with the beat at the start.
Daryl DMC McDaniels recalls, "Our thing was, go get Toys in the Attic and play Number 4. We had no idea that they were singing or what the song was, but we knew the beat. It was a hard break beat." Aerosmith had originally written Walk This Way in 1975. The structure was more funk imbued than the rest of their work, with guitarist Joe Perry inspired by the Meters song Sissy Strut. Singer Steven Tyler, being a drummer first, vocalist second, used his lyrics in a percussive fashion, half singing at speed with an emphasis on syllables rather than melody. The song was perfect for a crossover. The drums and guitar worked as a breakbeat in a similar way to how most hip-hop artists were using samples, and the quickfire lyrics could be easily rapped. Rubin managed to get Tyler and Perry to come into the studio to record on the collaboration, in spite of some initial hesitance on the part of Run DMC. At the time, rap music was rarely played on radio or MTV due to racial bias. Walk This Way changed this. With white rock musicians on the track, it was able to become a massive crossover event. The music video shows the previous divide. Run DMC in a tiny recording setup, Aerosmith next door in a massive club, before the wall between them gets broken down. Not only did it revitalize Aerosmith's flagging career, but it gave visibility to a burgeoning genre of music. Other rap artists at the time used rock music to further their style. LL Cool J's Rock the Bells used staccato guitar stabs. In a similar way to Jay-Z's 99 Problems two decades later. Hit me. Plus, there were the Beastie Boys, whose License to Ill album used samples of Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath, and AC/DC. As well as getting Slayer's Kerry King to solo on No Sleep Till Brooklyn. All these tracks, as well as Slayer's Rain in Blood, were produced by Rubin, making him arguably the godfather of rap rock. 80s metal shaped what new metal would become. While the mainstream MTV metal of Poison or Motley Crue was actively raged against, the more underground thrash metal bands like Metallica, Slayer, and Sepultura gave new metal bands a sound to aim for. Even if they didn't care for the precision soloing, being more enamored by the gut punch heaviness and aggression. The thrash metal band that had the greatest impact on nu metal was Anthrax. While Walk This Way was rap rock, Anthrax added something purely metallic to the mix on their I'm the Man EP. The guys from Anthrax weren't rappers. Their attempts are amateurish at best, but the track showed an interest and respect for the medium. So much so that hip hop firebrands Public Enemy collaborated with the band in 1991, both with a re-recording of I'm the Man featuring Chuck D and Flavor Flav, and more significantly, a cover of Public Enemy's Bring the Noise. The two groups' collaboration was coincided with an American-European tour through 91 and 92, with Anthrax's encore consisting of Public Enemy coming on stage to perform I'm the Man and Bring the Noise. Kerrang! Editor Paul Rees said in 2017, "I saw the Anthrax tour at Brixton Academy, and it was an exclusively white metal audience, but Public Enemy went down a storm. Groups like them and NWA and Eminem later, your parents would hate it. They were out there on that rebellious anti-establishment fringe. The mainstream press didn't like them, so that endeared them to metal fans." These kind of collaborations would continue throughout nu metal's reign, with Linkin Park and Jay-Z's Collision Course, The Executioners' It's Going Down, which features members of Linkin Park and Static X, as well as Exhibit, Method Man, Redman, and DMX appearing on Limp Bizkit's Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water. Some musicians felt that alternative rock, bands like The Pixies and Dinosaur Jr., were too lightweight, but that Metallica and Slayer were too heavy. Enter alternative metal, that most amorphous of genres. This included bands like who were only connected by being heavy in a way that no other band was being heavy. While a lot of those bands would influence nu metal in their own way, the alternative metal band that defined the down-tuned, crushing riffs that nu metal would adopt was Helmet. Just listen to Paige Hamilton's pile-driving guitar on tracks like In the Meantime. And here where Korn's Clown or Limp Bizkit's Break Stuff got their ideas from. The band would further the nu metal comparison with their partnership with House of Pain on the 1994 Judgment Night soundtrack, a compilation stuffed with rock-rap crossovers. Victimize! But you're in bed! Arguably, the band from the 80s alt metal scene that had the greatest influence on nu metal was San Francisco's Faith No More. Fronted by the charismatic Mike Patton with his MTV pin-up good looks and 6-octave vocal range, the band would make rap metal a legitimate thing with their 1990 top 10 hit, Epic. Can you feel it? See it? Hear it today. If you can't, then it doesn't matter anyway. Reportedly about Patton's disinterest in sexual intercourse, and it feels so good inside walking the glass. The track's video made them MTV famous. With his rap verses and soaring chorus, it would no doubt inspire Linkin Park on tracks like In the End and Numb. Faith No More's focus wasn't on flamboyant solos, but on lurching drum and bass grooves, that ka-chunk that flavored their best songs. As Faith No More's bassist Billy Gould said in 2006, "Guitar players have a tendency to drive the whole show, and bass and drums back that up, but we're the opposite of that." This alternative metal status would be a rallying cry for those that hated the flash and lack of substance of most MTV metal. Korn's Jonathan Davis said, "Faith No More made it so that you could play metal and not be a hair metal or glam band. They truly started to change things. The band would follow up The Real Thing with Angel Dust, as Entertainment Weekly called it, probably the most uncommercial follow-up to a hit record ever. A mixture of metal riffage, obscure samples, and on the closer, a cover of John Barry's theme to Midnight Cowboy. Initially seen as a commercial failure, the album has since become highly regarded. In 2003, Kerrang! Rated it as the most influential album of all time. Angel Dust's Anything Go approach would inspire the more creative of the new metal bands. System of Down, Slipknot, Deftones, and even math metalers Dillinger Escape Plan. Plus, their left field cover choices.
That's why I'm easy.
Would be taken to similar extremes by pretty much every new metal band.
Addie, you okay? You okay? You okay, Addie?
As well as being alt-metal, Faith No More also led the charge of a loosely assembled collection of funk rock acts that were gaining bands to watch status in 1989 to 1990. The movement was signified by a focus on groove and influence from 70s funk acts like Parliament Funkadelic, which required virtuoso bass playing, danceable beats, and a rhythmic vocal style. Chili Peppers' Anthony Kiedis told Penthouse in 2004, "We were early in creating a combination of hardcore funk with hip-hop style vocals. We became maybe an inspiration to Limp Bizkit, Kid Rock, Linkin Park, all these other bands that are doing that now." By the 90s, listening to hip-hop had spread to the suburbs, and anything that shocked the mainstream attracted teenage listeners and inspired the first waves of new metal and their imitation rapping. NWA's Straight Out Compton, Cypress Hill's Black Sunday, and Dr. Dre's The Chronic being specific calling points. Also deserving a mention for its combined controversy and metallic backing is Ice-T's Body Count and their band single, Cop Killer, written as reaction to the police beatings of Rodney King.
Cop killer, I know your family's grieving. Fuck 'em. Cop killer, but tonight we get even.
Politically minded in a way that few new metal bands would be, Rage Against the Machine's self-titled album is packed with left-minded sloganeering, combating police brutality, government oppression, and capitalism. The band's signature song, Killing in the Name, combined the punk rock anger of the Sex Pistols and Public Enemy with militant funk metal, cribbed and refined from Faith No More. A searing attack on the LAPD in the aftermath of the 1992 LA riots, the track encapsulates the message down to five lines, repeated as mantra into its final cathartic eruption.
Fuck you, I won't do what you tell me. Motherfucker! This is dedicated to the rap rock band that started this shit.
Years later, Rage bassist Tim Comerford said, "I do apologize for Limp Bizkit. I really do. I feel really bad that we inspired such bullshit." Then Korn came along and new metal existed. Their debut in 94 kickstarted with Blind and its shit-starting opening call.
Are you ready?
But was anyone truly ready? It was argued that Cold Chamber were the first band that could be correctly assigned the term, being that Korn's Jonathan Davis never rapped. But their metallic hip-hop sound was still a template for every band yet to come. Deftones' debut came out in 95, before Limp Bizkit, Snot, and a million other mildly disenfranchised scenesters jumped onto the bandwagon. There were high points. Deftones' entire catalogue, Hybrid Theory's high-caliber pop metal nearly two decades on, and System of a Down's schizoid Chop Suey is perhaps the genre's sole perfect moment. Wake up. But the low points were numerous and inescapable. Too much of the genre was defined by its key listeners, who merely needed a soundtrack to piss off their parents, so the music rarely exceeded that specification. By 2003, most of the first wave of bands had either become self-parody or turned their back on the genre altogether. Nu metal, as dismissed as it was the next step in rock music. A continuation of grunge which forced its self-hatred outwards onto anyone and anything that it would make sense for your average suburban kid to despise. It was the anger of punk and hip-hop, but unfocused and spewed everywhere, mixed with the unrefined heaviness of metal. While the music itself had limited weight, its popularity tells us something about the music listeners of the era. Bored by the glossy, manufactured pop that was being peddled on TRL, this uncompromisingly ugly music was a genuine alternative to the Hansons, Spearses, and NSYNCs of the American mainstream. Nu metal's influence is still felt today in acts like Bring Me the Horizon, Little Peep, and Little Uzi Vert, who are all raised on the genre. Similarly, new music by bands like have been compared favorably to nu metal, perhaps signaling a renaissance. Even 25 years since its inception, people might hate it, it may be toxic, and it might be mostly remembered as an embarrassment. But nu metal, and those that inspired it, might gain critical classic status sooner rather than later. This video is sponsored by ExpressVPN. I'm constantly on the move, so I'm frequently using public and potentially unsafe Wi-Fi hotspots. Without a VPN, you're putting your personal information in danger. ExpressVPN encrypts your internet data, preventing others from sniffing out your information when you're using a public Wi-Fi network in hotels, cafes, airports, etc. ExpressVPN enables users worldwide to protect their privacy and security online. It's easy to use. Just one click is all you need, so you're able to use internet without restrictions. As the name suggests, ExpressVPN is consistently faster than other VPN providers. ExpressVPN also has 24/7 customer service, so you can get help when you need it. If this sounds like the VPN service you need in your life, you can get 3 months free with a 1-year package. Visit expressvpn.com/trashtheory to learn more. After that, it's less than $7 a month with a 30-day money-back guarantee. Thanks for watching. What did I inevitably miss out? If you liked it, like, comment, and subscribe. Maybe also check out my Patreon and its many rewards. Shout out to my top tier supporters. You're all awesome. See you in 2 weeks.